हेलो हेलो चेक हेलो हेलो चेक चेक हेलो 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 चेक हेलो 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 चेक हेलो
मॉर्निंग, कैन यू हियर मी? वेल, राइट. सो वी कंटिन्यू दिस सैंपल साइज फॉर्मूला विच वी हैव ऑलरेडी डन फॉर रैंडमाइज कंट्रोल ट्रायल टू कोहोर्ट स्टडी एंड केस कंट्रोल स्टडी. So, as you know, we just to remind you that sample size calculations are rough estimates. So don't be very sticky to one number. If you get 196, that doesn't mean you have to stick to 196. You can estimate as 200. And the sample size required is very much like power of a microscope. If you want to detect small effects, which means maybe 1% difference in mortality for new treatment compared to old treatment. Like when streptokinase came, mortality was 30-day mortality of myocardial infarction was around 10%, let's say. When Eltepleis came as an improvement, then people designed trial to detect 1% difference between streptokinase and Eltepleis. Now, that difference must be clinically important, but given that millions of people get heart attack every year in the world, 1% was considered clinically important because 1% of millions means so many lives will be saved. So if you want to detect a small effect, then obviously like power of the microscope, you need a high power, means high sample size, large sample size. But if you want to detect large effects, like 20% difference, then you need low power, which means smaller sample size. And no sample size calculation can be done without some preliminary information, some observational study, some a priori hypothesis. So remember, these are very fundamental things. And it also depends on what is your hypothesis. So it's not only about randomized trial. Even suppose smoking and bladder cancer has association, not like lung cancer. Smoking and bladder cancer may not be as strong association as lung cancer. So if you want to detect association which is, let's say, weaker, you need a bigger sample size compared to a stronger association between smoking and lung cancer. So remember, that's a general rule. So what we have done last time was a sample size calculation for randomized control trial. If we have two groups of equal size, so 1:1 random allocation, and they are parallel groups, not crossing over, then with our hypothesis of superiority, let's say in patients with hypertensive intracerebral hemorrhage, surgery reduces 30-day mortality from 40% with only medical management to 20% with surgery plus best medical management. So a difference of 20%. It is not necessary to give both percentages. People may give 1% and a difference. And then you can calculate how much is the other percentage. So remember, we sort of indicated something which is without exposure, in this case without exposure to surgery, as P0. Zero we didn't read, we read it as PO. But basically it means zero exposure, no exposure, right? And PE is the exposed group, so we called it PE. So remember, these are not that you have to use the same sort of abbreviation always. It is for convenience, exposed PE, not exposed PO, which is actually zero. So remember, if we only told you that best medical management is associated with 40% mortality, but surgery may create a difference of 20%, then you know what the PE is. And then, as we said, find out their average. 20% plus 40% divided by 2. So the average is 30%, which we call P. So it's a average of PE and PO. So it's P, and the difference we call D. And then anybody remembers the formula? 16P into 100 minus P divided by D square, right? So from this, you can calculate the sample size. It will be 16 into 30 multiplied by 70 divided by 400. How much does it come to? This is per group. Remember, it is per group. 84 per group. So total sample size will be 168. That's right. This is what you did. Difference is D, and so this is the formula. 16P 100 minus P divided by D into D. So this comes to sample size of 168. So this you have done, right? If there are losses to follow up, let's say 10%, then you have to adjust for losses to follow up. 10% means if you start with 100, then you have follow up only of 90. So to have 90, you have to have a sample size of 100. So to have 168, you have to have a sample size of, you remember unitary method, 100 by 90 multiplied by 168, so it becomes 187. So similarly, if you have 20% losses to follow up are anticipated, which is not good, but if you are planning as that it is inevitable, then to have 80 you have to plan for 100, to have 168 you have to plan for 100 by 80 into 168, which is 210. Done. This is these things we have covered. So remember, this is the formula, right? 16P into 100 minus P divided by D into D. And this is for a study with two equal size parallel groups, right? Now, just one study which was published very recently. This is comparing high flow oxygen therapy versus conventional oxygen therapy on incidence of mechanical ventilation and clinical recovery in patients with severe COVID-19. Now, there is no reason why this study could not have been done here, right? You had high flow, you had conventional flow. If you knew how to do a randomized trial, you could have done this and published in JAMA. People say, how can we publish in JAMA? It doesn't require anything more than what you already have. So this idea that you need a big laboratory and latest gadget to publish in best journals is a myth. It is necessary in some studies. But many studies you can publish in very good journals just by designing a good randomized control trial. So what these people did, they said that if we do conventional oxygen therapy, probably 60% people will require invasive mechanical ventilation or will not recover. If we use high flow, probably it will make a difference of 20%. So 60% will become 40%. Now, what is the sample size? If 60% is hypothesized to become 40%, what is the sample size given our formula? Whosoever comes first. sample size will be 100 per group. Don't forget this. It is 100 per group. So total sample size will be 200. Is it clear? because 60% will go into mechanical ventilation or non-recovery, and high flow will make it 20% less, which is difference of 20%, so 40%, so 60 and 40, average is 50, so 16 into 50 into 50, divided by D, which is 20 into 20, so if you cancel 0, 0 and 4 into 4, then it is 4 into 5 into 5, which is 100 per group. This is the sample size which they have calculated. Assuming an intubation rate of 60% in patients with acute respiratory hypoxemic failure undergoing conventional oxygen therapy, which came from studies, I told you some studies should be there, we estimated that enrollment of 196 patients would be necessary to demonstrate an absolute reduction of 20% in the rate of intubation between the high flow oxygen therapy and conventional oxygen therapy groups with 80% power and two-sided alpha of 0.05. I told you last time that it is for 80% power, and which is beta of 0.2 or 20% and alpha of 5%, right? So there is no reason why this study could not have been done in RIMS. It is just a question of planning and thinking and doing it. And medicine department lost a great opportunity, I think, with critical care to do studies like this. Now, let's come to cohort study. Now, what I'm going to say is applies for cohort study of both retrospective type or prospective type, right? So, what is a cohort study, if you remember? This is the diagram I shared with you last time, that there is a population, your patient population, for example. Some may have exposure to a variable and some may not have exposure to a variable. Then you follow them up to find out outcome yes, outcome no. Outcome yes, outcome no. If it is a dichotomous outcome, binary outcome, means it is a categorical outcome with two categories. Okay? What will be an example? An example will be, suppose you want to know whether mortality of males and females is different in patients with COVID-19, for example. Now, you may think this may not be an interesting question, but if you just go and search gender equity in healthcare, can you do that on your mobile, Dr. Ganesh? You will find hundreds of papers. And it has been done in many, many conditions. You can search for myocardial infarction. Hundreds of studies have been published which show that females die more often in myocardial infarction as compared to males. Females get less often revascularization than males. Now, this doesn't require a big gadget to demonstrate this, right? You have exposure to one gender, male or female. So, that is exposed, not exposed. And then find out 3,600 papers. So just check for myocardial infarction. So you will find hundreds of papers which have been. What is the gadget which is required? Nothing. Just an observational study. You can't randomize people to become male or female. So you have to do observational study. It can be a cohort study. Equal number of males and females can be taken. They can be followed up and find out whether they died or survived, whether they had revascularization, didn't have revascularization. If you had a good hospital record, you can do it retrospectively also. And you can publish in a very good journal if you have done it properly. This is not a very insignificant question. So suppose we wanted to do that. First thing you have to think is, what is the relative risk which you are going to determine और एस्टिमेट. कोहोर्ट स्टडी एंड्स अप विद अ रिलेटिव रिस्क, दैट इज द इन अ डाइकोटमस आउटकम एंड अ बाइनरी आउटकम. इन आउटकम विद टू कैटेगरीज इट एंड्स अप विद रिस्क रेशियो और रिलेटिव रिस्क. समटाइम्स पीपल यूज हैजर्ड रेशियो, बट वी विल कम टू दैट लेटर ऑन, वी आर नॉट डिस्कसिंग दैट टूडे. सो वॉट इज रिस्क रेशियो और रिलेटिव रिस्क? इट इज रेशियो ऑफ प्रोपोर्शन ऑफ एक्सपोज्ड हैविंग द इवेंट्स एंड प्रोपोर्शन ऑफ अनएक्सपोज्ड हैविंग द इवेंट्स. सो इफ फीमेल सेक्स इज एक्सपोजर, then proportion of females having the event, which is death for example, and proportion of unexposed means those who are not females, so males having events, which let us call it P0. So exposed and unexposed is PE and P0, and relative risk will be PE upon P0, right? So that is what we want to estimate. Now since our formula doesn't have RR anywhere, we have the formula based on proportion exposed and proportion exposed having the events, proportion unexposed having the events, like our surgery and intracerebral hemorrhage example. We had people getting medical treatment, people getting medical and surgical treatment. So that is also like proportion dying. Exposed means after surgery, proportion dying, unexposed means without surgery, and then we did this. Now, if you only know that if we don't expose people, then proportion of those people who die without exposure is, let's say, P0. And you have a relative risk of 2, for example. Then what will be PE? Proportion in exposed. Proportion unexposed, P0, is, let us say, for example, 20%. And relative risk you estimate is 2. Then what will be the proportion of people dying with exposure, which means PE? Right. So 20% and relative risk of 2 will be 40%. That's how you will get 2, no? PE will be 40%, PO will be 20%, so relative risk will be 2, right? So in this example, suppose incidence of mortality is 50% in exposed group, incidence of mortality is 25% in unexposed group, let's say exposed to antibody cocktail in COVID-19 and not exposed, 50% versus 25%, then relative risk is 2. Now, when you are planning a cohort study, you must have some idea of what will be the event rate in those who are not exposed, right? That is, P0 must be coming from observational studies. So if you have already done observational study or there is a reported observational study, and you know that people who are exposed to alcohol, for example, they die of cirrhosis, let's say 20% is the mortality over 6 months, then if those who are having alcohol or alcoholic cirrhosis, what will be the mortality? You have to estimate. And you think it will be double, then it is relative risk of 2. Right, so remember this much. Any risk factor, exposed to a particular gender, exposed to a particular age, exposed to a particular habit, exposed to a particular treatment. So all of these will be called exposed group, right? So incidence in unexposed group, you will know from previous study, which may be in the literature. Then you estimate the relative risk. In this case, we are taking example of 2. And the question is, how do you estimate the relative risk? It will be hypothesized because you don't know exactly. But there should be some reason to think what the relative risk will be, either because of your clinical experience or because some pilot study. So some relative risk you must have idea about which you want to estimate. So this is what it is. Relative risk is equal to proportion. I think E should be upstairs. There is some mistake here. PE should be numerator, PO should be denominator. If that is the case, then PE will be PO multiplied by RR. This is what you were doing, right? So you get PE, you get PO. Then what is the D? D is PE minus PO. And then the same formula. So all the difference between what we did in randomized trial and what we did here is that in cohort study, you have to have some hypothesized relative risk. From relative risk and PO, you calculate PE. Then PE minus PO is D, and PE plus means average of PE and PO is P, and apply the same formula, 16P into 100 minus P. In decimal, it becomes 1 minus P. So actually, it should be 100 minus P divided by D squared. Okay, so that is in the cohort study. So if you want to demonstrate that females die more often, twice more often than males, then all you need to do is, you should have some idea of what is the mortality in males and how control group is supposed to represent what is the exposure in the population, right? And what you are going to show is that cases have more often exposure than in the general population. Cases in this case, cirrhosis cases. So cirrhosis cases have more often exposure to alcohol than those who don't have cirrhosis. And that should be representative of what is happening in the population. So cases and controls, and then you ask them, do you take alcohol? Yes or no? So exposure, yes, exposure, no. Now, if your idea is alcohol addiction, then you have to have some scale to define addiction and say alcohol addiction, yes, alcohol addiction, no. Similarly, take controls, those who don't have cirrhosis, and see how many have alcohol addiction and how many don't have alcohol addiction. Remember, since we are starting with cases, we can't talk about incidents, right? So what we talk about is odds of exposure in cases and odds of exposure in controls, right? With some other day, we'll talk about difference between odds and difference between incidence. But at present, it is good enough to say, what is the odds of exposure in cases? What is the odds of exposure in controls? Then you take a ratio. So it will be what? That will be called odds ratio, right? So this cohort study gives you relative risk, case control study gives you odds ratio. So we found out from relative risk what is the PE. So PO is actually with proportion of people having events without exposure. And we multiply that by RR to get PE. Now, I will repeat again. Proportion of people who have events without exposure, which is PO we are calling for the sake of our discussion, that should be known to you from observational study. So similarly, in case control study, you should know what is the proportion of controls who are likely to be exposed. That means population level exposure of alcohol should be known to you. You may not know accurately, but you should have some idea what proportion of people are alcohol addict in population. and what is the odds ratio you are trying to estimate, which means what will be the prevalence of alcohol addicts among cases compared to controls. It will be twice, it will be thrice, it will be four times. Accordingly, odds ratio will be 2 or 3 or 4. Is it clear? So now we are playing with odds ratio. In cohort study, we dealt with relative risk or risk ratio. So odds ratio, again, if you have some idea of estimate of controls, or exposure in controls, which we will call again PO, then PE can be determined from PO and odds ratio, right? But because odds ratio is a ratio of odds, not a ratio of incidence, so formula gets a little complicated, but doesn't matter. All you have to do is apply that formula. So I've already told you that if you are going to find out odds ratio, odds of exposure in cases, odds of exposure in controls gives you odds ratio. For example, and that you will know perhaps from the investigations which you have done, or you can even take population-based controls, go to the community and take controls. So suppose you have 100 cases of lung cancer and 100 controls, and then you find out percentage of people who have exposure to smoking and no exposure to smoking. So step 2, which is 1.5. Now you don't have to calculate before doing this study. All you have to do is you should know some, you should have some idea about exposure among controls, and then you can find out proportion of people exposed, proportion of people who among the cases who are exposed. That we call it PE. So this formula is not as simple as RR. It is slightly more complicated, which is you know the proportion of people who are exposed among controls, which is PO. You have to multiply by odds ratio and divide by 1 plus PO within brackets OR minus 1. That gives you proportion of people you will find exposed among the cases, right? So what is the idea? Idea every time is you already have PO, you want to find out PE so that you can apply the same formula, 16P 100 minus P divided by D into D, right? So in this case, this is the formula to find out PE from odds ratio and PO. So in every case control study, you have to estimate what odds ratio you are expecting. Then, Amit, you have to correct this. 16P, 100 minus P, same formula. Sorry? Scan copy, okay, right. So better correct this, right? He made this for us. So 16P 100 minus P divided by D square. So you will know from this formula what is the sample size in one group, which means how many controls you need and how many cases you need. That will be another N plus N, so 2N. Is it okay? So if you want to take some example and do it, you can do it. And I will let you do it at home, because we have to also cover another question, which is if you want to take more than one control, because you have a lot of patients in the hospital, right? So you may have some controls, one case, but you may want to take two controls, three controls. Some people take two types of controls, hospital-based control and also population-based control. So you may have two types of controls. So depending on what you want to design, you may want to have two controls per case, three controls per case, four controls per case. How does it help? It increases the power of the study. So if you want to do this, whether it is cohort or it is case control, this is the table you have to use. What we have done is, if two groups are of equal size, which means the top line, which is for one case, one control, that is 1:1, and then you find out n by 16p 100 minus p divided by d square. So for total sample size, you have to multiply by 2, so it becomes 2n, right? If you want to have 2:1, which means two controls per case, or two people exposed as compared to unexposed, two people unexposed compared to exposed, means 2:1, which means in a randomized trial, you want to give twice the number of people that medicine compared to controls. It was done because there was a study where people were doing a trial of carotid surgery, whether surgery helps to prevent stroke or not in people with stenosis. And already people were operating and saying, no, we see this is a good thing to prevent stroke. So when a randomized trial was planned, they said, we will have two people operated compared to one who will not be operated. So 2:1. So two exposed to surgery compared to one not exposed to surgery. So 2:1 kind of random allocation. If you wanted to do case control study, you want to take two controls per case. You want to do cohort study, you want two people unexposed compared to exposed. So you may have less number of people who are exposed. In this case, what you are doing is, you want to increase the number, total number, but to have the same power, 80% power, with 5% alpha, you will use these tables to get the numbers which you need, right? And this is the number. 2:1, you need, you calculate again n from 16p, 100 minus p divided by d squared. Same formula, but that gives you n, right? You want to have 2:1, then 0.75n for cases and 1.5n for controls. If it is a cohort study, 0.75n for those exposed and 1.5n for those who are unexposed, depending on which group you have bigger in your hospital. If you want 3:1, then it will become 0.67n and 2n for second group, which controls, and 2.67n. If you want 3:1, 4:1, then it will be 0.62n in the cases and 2.5n controls. So total will become 3.12n. If you want 5:1, then 0.6n versus 3n. So total becomes 3.6n. You see? Like that, if you want 100 controls per case, then 0.5n and 50n, right? So that is the number you have to do. So it increases your sample size by 50 times. As you can see, for 80% power for which this table is made, after 4 controls per case, there is hardly any gain by having 5:1 controls, right? 5:1 slightly increases by 0.5, your number increases, doesn't really help very much. So it is said that no point having more than 4 controls per case, maximum 5, but generally people have 2 or 3 controls per case. Or 2-3 times people who are unexposed compared to exposed in cohort study, 2-3 times people exposed to treatment versus not treatment. So whether it is case control, randomized trial or cohort study, this table will help. If you have more people in one group compared to the other group, right? So what we have done is, we have only talked about dichotomous outcome, binary outcome where proportions are available. And this way, you start with the same 16p 100 minus p divided by d square, you get n, then either you have 2n in 1 is to 1 allocation, 1 is to 1 exposed unexposed, 1 cases per control, top line will help. The moment you want to make 2 is to 1, 3 is to 1, then you go down the table and get different numbers, right? So you must have read studies where there are 3 controls per case, 2 controls per case. This is how they design. But the basic formula which you have to remember in your head is m, 16p 100 minus p divided by d square, right? So this is how you can design a cohort study and a case control study, basically based on your hypothesized relative risk in case of cohort study, hypothesized odds ratio in case of case control study, and hypothesized difference which your exposure will make in case of randomized trial, right? So if you have this, then you have one of the proportion, get another proportion, and then apply same, find out average, find out difference, apply the same formula, 16p 100 minus p divided by d square. So thank you. I think we have 10 minutes for questions and answers. So we can go through it. If you want to have an example, you can have an example also. Let's say for odds ratio of 2, right? For odds ratio of 2, if proportion who are likely to be exposed in controls, let's say is 20%, and odds ratio is 2, then what will be the PE? We can go back to the formula. PO is 20%, odds ratio is 2, so what will be the PE, which means proportion exposed among the controls, 20 into 2, 1 plus 20 into odds ratio is 2 minus 1, which will be 1. So again, it will be 1 plus 20. So 40 divided by 21. So PE will be something like almost, it is in decimal, so 20% will be the PE, which means you have to have, again now calculate the 16P 100 minus P divided by D square, you get N, and then similar N in the control group. This is for 1 is to 1. So next time we will do some exercises with this.
So there is an online question. Sir, how to include cluster design effect in case control sampling?
Cluster design is slightly different type of design. In case of a cluster randomized trial, we have to have what is called intra-class correlation coefficient, and then we have to calculate what is the multiplication factor for designing it. We will come to cluster design later on. So we will have another session on that. Any other question online? You can. So we will, next time we will do some exercises on controlling, calculating sample size for cohort study and case control study. Amit, you can find out from literature some papers, and we will do the exercise, right? Any other question? Right. What we have not done is where there are no groups, there is only one group, like we want to find out sensitivity of a test, specificity of a test. So you will have cases, you will have controls, how many, that's a different thing. Not, we are not finding out odds ratio, we are just finding out sensitivity of a test, specificity of a test. So if we estimate sensitivity is 90%, then how many cases we need? If we estimate specificity is 95%, then how many cases we need? We have not discussed this, because that is calculated for each group separately, right? It is not, you are not trying to find out ratio between the two groups. You are not trying to find out sensitivity divided by specificity, no. You are trying to find out sensitivity from the cases, specificity from the controls. So how many cases you need? How many controls you need? I shouldn't say controls in the conventional sense. We should say non-cases. How many cases you need? How many non-cases you need? If you want to find out sensitivity of, let's say, rapid antigen test in COVID-19, how many cases you need? Cases with COVID. How many persons you need without COVID? So they are not really controls in usual sense. They are basically non-cases. That we will do next time, right? Same formula which I will tell you for that will apply to survey, for example. If you want to do survey in the community and want to find out how many people have diabetes, for example, you have to have some estimate that I think we will have 20% people who have diabetes. And then the question will be to how many people we need. Obviously in the community, 20%, if 20% have diabetes, then 80% don't have diabetes. So it will be, as you can see, you have to plan in a way that when you do, you get enough number for sensitivity. In that process, you will get enough number for specificity also. So, but the question will be how many sample size we need to do the survey so that we get this 20%, right? You may have only one figure, which is prevalence. So you are not doing finding out percentages in both. Or if you want to study a diagnostic test in a population, then how many people you need with disease, how many people you need without disease? That is the question we will address next time. So next time we are going to cover these two things, diagnostic test and survey. And you will be surprised that the same formula with little different orientation, 16p 100 minus p divided by d into d will do the trick. Now that is something, if you have to change the orientation a little bit, d becomes slightly different. P is easy, but d becomes slightly different. But still, you don't have to remember another formula. You have to remember how I can adjust the same formula to find it out, right? So by the end of 3-4 sessions, at least you will remember this formula, right? And if you know how to use that in different settings, you can find out sitting on a coffee table what is the sample size you require. Okay? Any other question? If not, then thank you very much. Thank you.